All right, so I think that's time. Let's go ahead and get started. So welcome to this tutorial on MEMS-based oscillators. I'm Clark Nguyen. I'm a professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences at the University of California in Berkeley. And I even have a slide that says more about me, just so that you can see where I'm coming from in this tutorial. So I got my PhD at UC Berkeley. That was back in 1994. In 1995, I joined the Department of IEEE-UFFC at the University of Michigan. I then went off to DARPA for a while, but then came back to Michigan for 6 months, but then moved to UC Berkeley. Went back to UC Berkeley in 2006. And so my research is exactly the topic that I'm talking about right now, which is MEMS and RF MEMS and timing using MEMS, but also things like filters and that sort of thing for receivers. Teaching, at least at the University of Michigan, I taught mainly transistor-level design courses. And at UC Berkeley, I'm still teaching a lot of these transistor design courses, things like 143, which is microfabrication technology, 243 as well, microfabrication. The twos are the graduate courses, the ones are the undergraduate upper division. 245 and 247 B are MEMS courses. And ME218 is also a MEMS course. So those are the types of classes I teach at Berkeley. In 2001, I founded the company Nisera, which is the first company to commercialize MEMS-based oscillators. It didn't win. Okay, the winner is Cytone, and so we'll say a few things about that later on. But I do have that industry experience as well in MEMS-based oscillators. In mid-2002 to 2005, I took a leave from Michigan for about 4 years to go to DARPA, which is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Lots of money was let out to MEMS during that period and even before that period. So I think I put about $356 million into MEMS research in various areas. You can see some of the areas down there: power generation, chip scale atomic clock, which is something that you see talked about from John Kitching. We'll talk about that later on. I won't, because I think John will. Chip scale atomic clock definitely is a MEMS technology. That's what, to me, that's what made that possible. People will debate that. But hey, I was the program manager that ran that program, so I have the right to say what it is. It's MEMS, or MEMS and photonics, that made it possible. Gas analyzers, which are sort of sensors, nuclear power sources, this is like radioisotope power sources, the navigation grade gyros, on chip cooling, environmental control, really a packaging program or so. And so there's my experience with a lot of different MEMS. I won't be talking about all those. I'll be talking mainly about oscillators. And finally, these past 2 years, I've been president of the UFFC, so ultrasonic ferroelectric frequency control. That's my background. That's who's talking to you. And so now let's get on to the material here that we'll be covering. So just my outline. I'll say a few things about MEMS technology, but I don't want this to be about technology, because there's just a lot of technologies to look at. We'll look at a few technologies, and I think I'll point out all of them. But when we start looking at oscillator design, I'll focus in on one of them, and I'll focus in on the one that you see out in products right now, which is the capacitive transduce type resonators there. And again, reason why it is the capacitive transducer resonators that have dominated the oscillator market so far. There are some reasons for that, and it has to do with the oscillator design. So I'll talk about some application drivers for MEMS-based oscillators, some addressable oscillator types, and then we'll go on to some oscillator fundamentals. And for this group, maybe I see some older people, or maybe that'll be boring for you, maybe the youngers will like some of that there. And we'll talk about phase noise and where it comes from, you know, how you design oscillators and that sort. Then we'll start talking about MEMS-based resonators. And then here's where I'll talk about different technologies, but I won't focus in on that. What I really want to focus in on is the design of these oscillators and why MEMS makes tons of sense in this. So we'll give an example of a MEMS-based oscillator that should illustrate all the advantages of using MEMS over other technologies, possibly quartz and that sort. And then we'll talk about some of the harder problems to tackle in any oscillator, and that is things like stability, so acceleration sensitivity, aging, and thermal drift, and compensation. Now, I'm looking at this from the university perspective. I know what's going on with SciTime, and I know SciTime is about to present some stuff that I think will blow people away in terms of how stable they will be. So this is finally, we've reached a point now. I mean, you were saying in 2004, right, people were sort of saying MEMS would never go anywhere. 2010 was the same thing. I think MEMS has gone somewhere now, start, let's talk a little bit about MEMS technology. And I only have three slides on this because I don't want this to be about fabrication, and so we could spend weeks on that topic. But here's one way to fabricate a MEMS device. First of all, what is a MEMS device? It's a micromechanical device. It's really a structure, so it can mechanically move in any of three dimensions. And so maybe it could be something like this freestanding beam that's anchored right here, and there's the beam with an air gap between it and the substrate. So how do you make something like this? Well, here's something like this. So these are the anchors right here for this structure. This is sort of the shuttle of it. This is a classic folded beam comb-driven resonator from 1989 or so. First came coming out for Bill Tang. I was a Bill Tang's undergraduate golfer while this stuff was going on, so it was really cool to see this thing come up. And, you know, we discovered a lot of things. Extinction was something no one knew about. It took us at least two runs of the process to figure out what was wrong with the devices if they were just stuck. So no one knew what extinction was at that time. But anyway, how is this fabricated? The rest of this is suspended. You can see the shadow under there. It's suspended 2 microns above the substrate there. So here's the process. You start with a silicon substrate, and you're basically using the technologies that you already find in semiconductor fabs to make this mechanical device. And so you may put down an oxide here, maybe 2 microns thick of isolation oxide. Isolation is mainly electrical isolation because we'll have interconnects on top of this. Put down a nitride here. Why would we do that? That's just more electrical isolation. That's to protect the oxide underneath from hydrofluoric acid etch that we're going to do at the end of this that would otherwise attack this isolation oxide. And then we put down a interconnect layer. In this case, it's polysilicon doped, probably Paco doped, phosphorus doped, or something like that, or maybe even in situ doped. So it's electrically conductive. Then pattern this using photolithography into what will become a ground plane and the electrical interconnect right here. Then put down another layer of oxide. This we'll call sacrificial oxide because we're going to remove this before the process is done. But right now we need it to support layers that will actually become the structural layer. Then etch out an anchor here that will be this anchor here that you're going to use to support your structure. Then put down a blanket deposition of your structural layer. In this case, it's polycrystalline silicon. All sorts of know-how on how to do this. This is not just putting down silicon like in a transistor circuit. You've got to get your stress correct. You've got to get all sorts of things correct here, which means your recipe has to be very, very well-planned. Right? You had to develop this recipe over a good amount of time. There's a lot of good recipes out there, but this is the part where if you're a transistor-level designer, you don't want to do this. It's going to take you a long time to do this. I can spend weeks, again, jumping on courses, teaching how to get this right, this layer here. But let's just say we have it right. At this point, you may just pattern it to create the mechanical structure that you get in lithography and etching of the polysilicon. And so finally, you've achieved this structure. We have your structural layer temporarily supported by this sacrificial layer here. You then dip the whole thing into your release etching, in this case, hydrofluoric acid, which attacks the oxide but does not attack the structural polysilicon, or at least attacks it at a very slow rate. Everything gets attacked at a finite rate. It doesn't attack the nitride either, or attacks it at a very slow rate as well. And so at the end, you remove that oxide, and you don't have this freestanding beam, free to move in any of three dimensions. Right? And so that's an example of a very popular MEMS-based process. Examples of companies that have used analog devices as well. They've used surface micromachining polysilicon. A lot of other examples of people using them. Now, there's also bulk micromachining that are going on. So in this instance, let me describe a bulk micromachining process that bonds to a wafer at the end. And so bulk micromachining, instead of depositing your structural layers, you're actually using the silicon wafer or whatever kind of wafer it is itself to make your MEMS device. So in other words, there's some examples of bulk micromachining devices. You can see the point. You may not be able to tell, but this is a lot thicker layer. This was 40 microns. They have things that are 100 microns now. But in this era, this is one of Glenn Jaffe's gyroscopes, wine glass gyroscopes from a while back. And so this is about 40 microns high. It's got these electrodes on the edges here. This is another thing that was bulk micromachining. This is actually a rotor for a wall motor that was auto did at UC Berkeley. Wankel motor, sorry. Not Wankel motor. And, you know, at least least for this device here, the process technology was basically take your solvent substrate. Now you want to use that substrate as your actual mechanical material. And so you start etching into the substrate. And you have to etch deep, and that's where the Bosch deep reactive ion etch process was sort of revolutionized MEMS. And they did that many, many years ago. So maybe revolution isn't the right word at this point. But you can make some very deep 90-degree cuts, straight cuts into your silicon. That sort of defines the actual structure here. You then take a glass substrate. You also mentioned that to create anchor points here and air gaps where this thing will be sitting above. And then we'll probably want to put down some interconnecting. Well, oftentimes you can use metal for that. You then flip over your silicon substrate. You bond this to the glass substrate, and then you etch away the silicon substrate and wet etch it, which is what they're using. And so you end up then with just your structures there that could be very thick. They're anchored at some point. You have electrodes around this, and you can sort of see the one-to-one between these two right here. So this is actually called the dissolved wafer process, something that the people at the University of Michigan used a lot. There's a lot of companies that came out using this process as well. And so this is just the bulk micromachine aspect of MEMS. Now, getting closer toward timing, this is just straightforward MEMS manufacturing or construction here. In timing, you need to have a very pristine environment around your MEMS device. Okay, so this is where SciTime has done the best job. And this all came about because of the concept that was used to design the SciTime-like resonator here. It was basically, instead of thinking of designing the device itself first, they thought package first. So this is out of Tom Kinney's group. It was basically Tom's idea was, let's design the package while we're designing the device, which is not what a lot of MEMS people did. A lot of MEMS people just designed their device, and the package was an afterthought, which is really the worst thing you can do if you want to put a product down, because usually the package costs the most. It's the most difficult to do. Tom did it in a way where they were thinking the package and the device at the same time. Some sacrifice in the device, the gaps between the device and the electrode are kind of large, and we'll say why that is maybe not be the best situation for us, and it makes SciTime struggle a bit to get some of these oscillators here. But in the end, they're sealing this whole thing. So if I went through this process, and something where you can see single crystal silicon is being used as your actual structure, you start with an SOI device. You have silicon oxide, silicon here. I don't know if everyone can see that very clearly there. You have these slides. You actually have more slides than I'm going to show today, because I just gave you too many. But you have these as well. So this ends up being the resonator element here. These end up being, say, things that would support or electrode type material there. And then what happens is an oxide is deposited here, so non-conformal LTO to sort of fill this up. I guess they're even showing keyholes there. I would not like to have keyholes there if I would deposit an MP over that. But apparently, this was how this was drawn. I bet they plug those keyholes. I know this process to some extent because Tom's PhD student became a postdoc in my group. So I know the insides of this process fairly well to be able to talk about it. So after this is done, an epi deposition of silicon is done. So of course, epi means you're growing silicon, but over oxide, you're actually growing polysilicon, and you're going to have these divisions between those, which is what these ragged lines are right here. And so this now, if this is the structure, you now see the encapsulation above the structure. After that, you then seal this with epi. In this case, this thing says non-conformal LTO, which is, I don't think, correct, because that's an epi seal that's done right there. So you see, in the end, it's an epi seal, where that's sealed in a furnace, sort of a polysilicon furnace, well, actually an epi furnace still. Okay, and you can see that it seals these, and what's great about this process is you're doing this entirely in a furnace, which means it's extremely clean. And even if there are, say, some gases left over here, they continue reacting out such that you have an extremely clean environment now around any of your resonant structures. This is the secret behind the stability that SciTime is able to get. It's a brilliant process for things like oscillating. You'll see a lot of evidence of that at the upcoming conference. Now, you can also even put transistor circuits on this, which they don't do because maybe it doesn't work as well as it should at this point, but it doesn't need to, because a two-chip solution still works very well for this. There are other processes that can get integration of MEMS with transistors. Here's one process from a long time ago, but actually integrated structural polysilicon with CMOS here in a modular process. What you want is a modular process. I mean, there's other ways to do this. For example, you can do some of the MEMS, some of the transistors, some of the MEMS, and intersperse those process techniques. There are steps between those. That's horrible when one of them gets better. When the transistors get better, then you have to redesign the whole process, and that takes too much money to do that. So if you can keep it as modular as possible, like this, where all the transistors are done first, then the MEMS, that's the best way to do it. Unfortunately, that's the most difficult way to do it, because putting MEMS down above transistors means that the metallization of the transistors has to survive the temperatures of the MEMS. That's a difficult thing to guarantee, and so in this case, this was a process from a long time ago. The metal here is not your familiar aluminum or copper. That's where the metal here is tungsten. Okay? And when you think of what the IC industry has done, what it's costed them a whole lot of money, that was the metallization process. They have multiple levels of metallization. Lots of money was put in to develop that. So do you think the IC process will change their metals, aluminum and copper, just to accommodate a MEMS structure? The answer is no. Right? So MEMS has to find out a better way to do something like this integration, but this can be done and it does work. And so this is an example of one of the earliest, I would say, real-time clocks, all the way back in 1993 or so. You can see this was my PhD thesis, basically, in the end. And, you know, this combined the MEMS together with transistors. You're, again, using tungsten metallization, so no one used this afterwards. But it was proof of the pudding. It didn't work. It had decent, not even say decent stability. This was the first of its kind. It's nothing like the oscillators people can get today. But the beauty of this, and I want you to remember, is that the interface capacitance between the MEMS part and the circuits is tiny femtofarads here. With no bond pads needed. That is huge. If we can do this later on for MEMS, we'll talk about that when we start talking about circuit design. Okay, so that's all I'm going to say about the technology right there. So really briefly, technology. What is MEMS? Why do we want to use MEMS? What are the application drivers? I mean, after all, we already have quartz. Well, it's the same type of drivers for clocking, for frequency control that you're familiar with, for quartz, for atomic clocks, and that sort of thing. So better timing gives you more secure communications, right? More efficient spectrum utilization, longer autonomy periods, faster frequency hop rates, faster acquire sooner random signals. And all that sort of amounts to superior resilience against jamming, but more interception. Right? This is why we need good timing. Of course, the DoD definitely knows this, but some of you all are cellular networks these days. The other thing, right, network sensors, right? Maybe that's already here, maybe that's up and coming. People talk about a trillion sensor revolution or so. For that to work, the timing better be spot on. So better timing can also give you that. But not only better timing, very low power timing at the same time, right? These are sensors that maybe if there's a trillion of them interspersed over some difficult terrain, you can't go in and change their batteries. So whatever clock you have, better be consuming very little power there. And then, of course, there's GPS. And these are just three examples, right? You have better timing, then you need fewer satellites needed to do a location, right? Higher jamming margins, you can get faster acquired GPS. Timing gives you all of these things, okay? So if MEMS can help some of this, then this is absolutely one thing that you would want to use MEMS for. I think the ones that will really help with or something like this, or this, mainly because the power consumption could be a lot lower than what you could get with non-MEMS. So moving on, right, MEMS also makes a lot of sense in wireless communications. So sort of digging in on one of these things here. So there's your cell phone. It has a crystal oscillator right now, and you know, maybe MEMS can replace the crystal that's being used in that oscillator. So there's evidence that it should be able to do it. Whether it makes good market sense is what people are waiting for right now. The other thing that MEMS can be used for, of course, are the filters at the front end. And so outright, I will just say that's the better market, at least at this time. There's a reason why Broadcom can go out and try to buy Qualcomm. It's because they made tons of money on this, which is the F-bar filter. And it's a great product because there's not a lot of it. It's performance that matters. And not a lot of people can make these, at least the way that Broadcom oscillator and all these off-chip components, then maybe the dream is you can get a single-chip realization of the whole wireless communicator, which then may fit on a watch or something like that. Okay, so that's the big picture of how this might address conventional wireless communications. But there's also the unconventional stuff that becomes very interesting. So when we talk about sensors that require very little power consumption, a lot of times it's the wireless communications that consumes the most power. And so with MEMS, you can start thinking of alternative ways to do the wireless communications. If I go back here, that's a big system. So you have the MEMS parts or the mechanical part, but you also got all this electronics right here that's consuming a lot of energy. And if you don't need to have that much, if you don't need to have a huge bit rate, you can simplify the whole thing, especially if you have MEMS, especially if you have a good MEMS-based oscillator. So one way to do that is to make a super regenerate receiver. This is not a new receiver. This has been around for a long time, invented by the same person that invented the super heterogeneous receiver. So, but the neat thing about this, it consumes very little power because it's dependent really only upon a nice oscillator. And that's what this is. The MEMS resonator embedded in a feedback loop, a positive feedback loop with an amplifier. So that makes up the oscillator here. So here's where I start delving in a little bit into oscillator design. Here's the stitching that I'll show you here. This is basically an oscillator going on and off. Okay, so what super heterodyne is based on is an oscillator where you're sort of looking to see how fast that oscillator starts up. So it's definitely not linear oscillator to some part. But it can work really well as a very simple communication platform for very low power communication. So let's talk about oscillator. Here's where I started into this. What's an oscillator? In simplistic terms, you can think of it as just a frequency selective tank. Maybe a mechanical resonator like I'll be talking about here, but even just an LCR or so that will have a response that will peak out in a resonant frequency, put that in a positive feedback loop with a sustaining amplifier. It's going to go unstable. It's going to want to go unstable at the highest gain point, which in most cases will be at the peak point of your resonant tank. Okay, and so that will then oscillate, give you an oscillating signal. Now, if you want to use this oscillator for the super regeneration receiver that I talked about, then what you're doing is, you're letting this oscillator either start it from noise, in which case it'll take a long time to start up its oscillation, or if some signal from the outside, perhaps an electromagnetic wave comes in and couples its energy into the loop, that now starts up much faster. And so if it starts up fast, there's energy that you've received in the right band. And so that actually tells you there's a one that you've received. If there's no energy coming in, that's a zero. And so it's an OOK, on-off shift keying type of reception there. And this works. So this has been proven to work right here. So this is the actual design of this super regenerative receiver. I don't want to spend much time on this. So if this goes over here again, that's fine. This is not the... I'm still talking about oscillator applications for oscillators right now. But if you take, say, a signal here that's FSK modulated, so this is your bit stream that you want to see at the end of this thing, right up here. And you better have the same bit stream if you successfully receive this here. And so this is wirelessly transmitted over an antenna platform here. And, you're modulating a carrier with this bit stream here. So the ones would have a certain frequency, the zeros have another frequency. That's frequency shift keying there. That reaches the antenna on the receiver. That antenna then pushes out a differential signal, which first gets filtered by this MEMS-based resonator, which cleans it up. It kills off all the interfering signals, so you only get the signal you want. That then says whether you're putting energy into this oscillator loop. And so this is a loop now between these two electrodes and that resonator, and this sustaining amplifier, and then it's an oscillator that's growing and shrinking. If you take an envelope detector after that, this is the envelope you see. So you can see instances where this rises very quickly, instances where it takes a long time to rise. Those are the ones and the zeros there. You then put this into a comparator out here. That gives you this waveform. You should then flip that over with a flip-flop, which then gives you the received signal, which means it's the same as the transmitted signal. So this actually works as a receiver over a short distance. It's extremely low power. Okay, so 16 microwatts of transmit power, successfully decoded OOK. And then in the end, it consumed in the end. The original version was about 450 microwatts of power. Now it's down to 30 microwatts of power. That's use tiny oscillators, and especially tiny oscillators that consume very little power. So that power thing is going to be a big theme throughout this presentation, because it's power where MEMS has the biggest advantage. So when you see some of the oven-controlled oscillators that Tom Seidheim will show later on today, so later on this conference or so, the main advantage is power. You can oven-control with much less power. To get a certain phase noise, you can also do it with much less power if you're doing it in MEMS. And all those things I'll talk about. Last thing I'll say here is that resonant sensors are also a big thing for MEMS-based technology. So things like gyroscopes, like the one that I already showed here, especially when you're able to get these resonators together with electronics, you know, through a two-chip solution or fully integrated, this is also a huge application for MEMS-based oscillators, and applications where you want to make sure that you have a very stable oscillator in the long term and in the short term. Okay? So now let's talk about addressable oscillator types in MEMS. So first of all, I'd be remiss if I did not mention chip-scale atomic clocks. So this is a technology that sort of took a look at NIST F1 and said, hey, can we repeat that in a smaller size? There's no way you're going to repeat everything, right? You're not going to get the accuracy, right, of NIST F1, which is a fountain atomic clock here. But it turns out that you can get very close, and these are some of the initial versions of the symmetrical chip-scale atomic clock, to something that performs better than an oven-controlled crystal oscillator, but does it with much less power consumption. The goals of the program were to get this stability 10 to the minus 11 in an hour and get better than that. It actually ended up with 10 to the minus 12. But the power consumption of 30 milliwatts didn't make that. It's about 130 milliwatts right now is what it's doing. And the size should have been 1 cubic centimeter. The stuff that Microsemi is shipping is on the order of 10 cubic centimeters or so. But still, you know, tour de force. And it was MEMS technology that made a lot of this happen, in my opinion. Yeah, it was photonic technology as well, but the critical thing was MEMS to get the power down, and et cetera, that sort of thing. Again, I'm not going to say anything else about chip-scale atomic clock in this tutorial. I'm going to focus on the mechanical MEMS-based resonator clocks, which are the much higher volume type clocks here. So, you know, we know what the application space is here. You've got some high-end, or sort of some low-end applications like TVs and camcorders, computers that don't need the best oscillators out there, and they better have good jitter performance, but they don't need to be, say, communications grade, which you need to have in things like smartphones, right? You need to have very good phase noise on here. So we call these high-end applications, these low-end applications. For the longest time, they've been addressed, of course, by quartz crystals, right? Why? Crystals are thermally stable, they have a low drift rate, they have very high Q, right? Over 10,000, even beyond that there. But what you're seeing is these upstart MEMS companies coming in. And again, here's Tessera, which no longer exists and got bought up. And is, I guess it's been bought several times now. And then there's Cytime. Interestingly, MEMS, Tessera is in a company called Microchip. Cytime is in a company called Megachip. I don't know how that ended up. But Cytime is still sort of its own entity, right? You still see its products as Cytime. You don't see Tessera's products as Tessera products. Still out there, though. So these are the two companies, and there were other companies as well that put product out in the MEMS space. And so I'll say a lot more about this stuff. So far, they're addressing a lot of the low-end applications for Cytime. Their highest volume application is a real-time clock, and that is truly high volume. I would say that's the higher volume than any clock product out there. That doesn't mean they're making a lot of money. That may be the problem or something. It's a huge volume, but maybe the margins are high enough for that. And so I think even in the MEMS space, it makes more sense to make oscillators that are sort of the higher-end type oscillators. You can actually make better margins with those. I guess it wants us to $3.5 billion market. It's bigger than that right now. And so how do you go about making oscillators like this? I think I have something just like this later on, too. So let me use the one later on. This is talk about synthesizers and how to make these things. Let me talk about how to design oscillators later on. But the final thing, now a nice product that can come out of MEMS, what MEMS can really address, are the oven-controlled oscillators. If you look at an oven-controlled crystal oscillator, what are they doing? They're embedding a quartz crystal and sustaining electronics, maybe in a thermally isolated oven that maintains that stable temperature and eliminates thermal drift right at its source, right? You keep the temperature of the device constant. And so here's how you might do that, right? You take your quartz large crystal with the oscillator circuit. Your feedback control circuits may be on the outside or inside, but you've got to have a sensor and a heater in there as well. You got this big package around here. This is going to consume a lot of power. And the really good ones consume over a lot of power. The ones that are $20, maybe they're down in the hundreds of milliwatts or something like that. But still a good amount of power. But boy, do they perform nicely. Right? So if you have a single oven, you can achieve 10 to the minus 9 stability. Double ovens, even more stability. But the double ovens are the ones that will consume more of the energy there. And so there's problems with this, right? They're bulky. They're more expensive than TCXOs. Okay? I should say, if you want to ask a question, too, because I'm just going to keep moving on. If you want to ask a question, raise your hand and just speak up or sit up. And please do. Maybe we'll break, like, an hour in or something, just to make sure you can ask questions. Because I can just keep going like a machine gun, like this here. And so, let's see, long warm-up times needed, and neutral power needs. This is where MEMS can make a big difference. This is why CSAC really came about. Right? CSAC got the type of performance you can get from a really expensive oven-controlled oscillator, but with much less power consumption. That was the main thing that CSAC was able to get. Yes? Is the quartz also a MEMS device? You know, I'm so general about that, I would ask you to argue, yeah, maybe it is. Right? But there seem to be camps that will say, no, it's not, because it's just a little too big. Right? So F-bars, for example. Right? Initially, they were saying they weren't MEMS devices. Now there's a lot of people saying they're MEMS devices. I would say they really are MEMS devices because they're very small. Quartz can be very small, yeah. Size makes it, yeah. I would say yes, yeah. Well, the micro part of MEMS, yeah. So micro electromechanical system. So the micro is the size. But I'm open to opening it up to everything. I'll call anything MEMS if necessary. And so here I'm talking about chip scale atomic clock, but the real opportunity here is to do this not using an atomic physics package, but using a MEMS-based resonator that is so small that it takes very little energy to get it up to temperature. So that's what you're starting to see on groups, research groups. I guess Scientime doesn't have that yet, but research group, Tom Kinney's at Stanford. I mean, Tom is giving a talk sometime during this conference. He's the third plenary speaker. It'll be Thursday, I guess. Make sure if you want to see that, he's going to show some of the work, I'm sure. Just fantastic temperature stability and aging drift just because they're oven controlling this thing, but with very little power now, because it takes very little power to heat up something that's so tiny. And that's the huge advantage of MEMS in the end. And so here's some of that size thing, right? If we're looking at real-time clocks, there's a coin. I wish I remember what coin it was. Let's say it's a dime. But this is a citizen micro quartz crystal being used for real-time clocks. These are sort of prices and motion and resistances and volume. If you're buying these in volume. But here's another citizen micro, small one, the same 315. Here's an apricot, even smaller than that. Here's what MEMS can do. And so actually, this is a MEMS-based real-time clock, and this is how small it is. There's no price on this because I don't know the price and that sort of thing in volume. That's yes. Yes, so that's the thing. This is actually not packaged here. This is, how big does it get when it's packaged? It could be a lot smaller, but I will say that companies, like even my company, Desera, when we made oscillators, we could have made them a lot smaller, but we didn't. Because the people that wanted the oscillators basically just wanted something to plug into something they already had. And so we made them the exact same size as the quartz oscillators at the time, with the understanding that in the future generations of products, they could become smaller. And only the MEMS could make them smaller. So MEMS does end up being a lot smaller. It can end up being a lot smaller, but whether people actually ship them that way. So for example, for Scientime, they're in the Apple Watch. Those have to be smaller. Okay, so they can be smaller in the end, but that's a good question. And the packaging it is. With Scientime, right, the package comes for free almost, except when you have to combine it together with circuits. Right, and then that one may get a little bit bigger at that point. Okay. And so now let's stop talking about applications of MEMS and what it can service. And let's now talk about some oscillator fundamentals. And here's where we go into the limited design. And so first, here's this is straight from John Hank's tutorial that I ripped it off. box based on rubidium, cesium. There's a hydrogen laser here, which is sort of a workhorse of our unified timing. And this is where chip-scale atomic clock is, right there. You can see, right, it doesn't beat out on the quartz, but it does in terms of power consumption. Maybe you can define on this, and this is an Allen deviation plot right here, so you're plotting sort of the log of your stability in this case versus the time that you're averaging over here. And so anything below 1 second, maybe we'll call that short-term stability over, over 1 second, maybe long-term stability. That's a very loose definition of that. But you can see that quartz is great at short-term stability, better than some of these atomic clocks right here. We'll get the short-term stability really from quartz in the end anyway. But the long-term stability is where the atomic clocks shine. It's the aging and drift there that allow them to go this far off and stay very low here in the order of 10 to the minus 12, 10 to the minus 13, etc. And MEMS you can expect to be similar to where quartz can be, except hopefully with much less power consumption. Okay? And so let's talk about oscillators. You want that stability. And so where does that stability come from? And a lot of people will answer from a high quality factor of your resonator. And so here's an instance where you can sort of heuristically explain why it is you want that high quality factor in an oscillator. So again, an oscillator, we can take a tank circuit embedded in a positive feedback loop with some kind of gain element. In order for this to oscillate, you need to have around this loop a 0 degree phase shift. Okay, and that means you have positive feedback around that. And so you can take two cases. You can say that the Q of your tank circuit, which is how sharp that spectrum is low. If it's low Q, it's not a sharp spectrum. Versus high Q on this side. This is a Q of 10. This is a Q of 1,000. These are actually simulating response spectrum. So you can see how much sharper this is right here. And so you can take two situations. Say you got a temperature shift or so. What happens with that temperature shift? It could be about anything, right? Like a stress change or something like that. So what that stress change might do or temperature shift might do is just change the phase of one or both of these components by just a little bit. So maybe if this was 0 degrees across this gain element, this now 0 degrees minus this delta theta. In order to keep a 0 degree phase shift across this, your resonant element now has to take on a positive delta theta. Okay, and so let's see what happens when we get that delta theta. So for low Q, I got a very gradual phase change with frequency here. And you can see that in order to sustain that, say that delta theta was 40 degrees, which is an exaggeration of what you would get. Okay, you would have to sustain a frequency shift of 400 kilohertz in order to keep that shift 0 degrees across this. That's not stable. Okay, but if I had a much higher Q resonator of 1,000, I could sustain that 40 degrees and get barely any frequency shift right here. Okay, which means that I have a much more stable in terms of temperature stability and in terms of, you know, any type of thing that will cause a long-term change in frequency. Right, Q helps enormously here. And it's mainly because that phase shift is so sharp right there. So right away, you get better, but at least temperature stability and other types of drift stability, you do want that IQ. Yes? Yeah, so temperature will also cause the whole curve to move as well. So I'm simplifying the whole thing, right? So the resonator will also shift in frequency as well. I guess I should have said, suppose the resonator did not shift in frequency, right? Then your temperature stability depends on your Q, right? Once you have your Q as high as it is, now it depends on your resonator's temperature stability in the end, okay? But just the first step to get this, you have to have the high Q first. Otherwise, you're fighting all of this in addition to your resonator shifting in frequency. Okay, so that's more of the circuit design standpoint for this. Now, the other part where you want very high Q is low noise. Okay, so here's a heuristic picture of noise. I'll go into something more detailed in just a second here. But when you make an oscillator like this, again, tank and a positive feedback loop with a sustaining amplifier, now what you expect to come out is this ideal sinusoid. That's what you'd like to come out. But in reality, if you're at a finite temperature, you're at least going to have thermal noise. If you're using transistor-based gain electronics, you're going to have shot noise and flicker noise and all these other noise sources there. And you can think of this noise as just superimposing itself on top of this perfect sinusoid. So up here, perfect ideal sinusoid, this period never changes. If I plotted this in the time domain, it's a sinusoid. In the frequency domain, all the energies at a single frequency. Okay, like this delta function here. A real sinusoid has some variation in that amplitude and that phase, because now with your zero crossings, which sort of define your phase, these are now not happening at the same period, right? Ever so slightly, they're changing. So that means not all of your energy is at omega naught. Some of that energy is now in frequencies assigned omega naught. Okay? So that's noise. So in an oscillator, as I'll show, all of the output of an oscillator really is amplified noise, including the one you want, that deterministic sinusoid in a second. That's amplified noise. All the noise is actually noise too, and it's in the sideband, but we define the center frequency as your carrier, which is the signal you want. That's not noise. Anything not at that frequency is noise. Okay? And in the end, as I'll show very soon, if you have these sidebands here, that noise can cover up a signal you're trying to receive, for example, using a receiver, a wireless receiver. And so how do you fix this? High Q again. And so this tank circuit actually is filtering the noise. There's a lot more going on that's shown right here, and I'll talk about that in a second. But if I gave a higher Q tank, which is a sharper tank spectrum for that tank circuit, that will filter this to make that tighter, which makes this now look more like that. And so it's becoming more ideal. I get less of this sideband here, which means it interferes less with my communication. So let's talk about communications right now. What am I talking to? So if I have a receiver, it's a wireless communicator. So what's that receiver doing? So say this is the information, or the power received, power picked up by the antenna. Okay, the first thing these receivers do is they want to mix down from this very high frequency to much lower frequency. The reason is, it's much easier to do amplification to modulation at much lower frequencies. So they mix it down here. And the way that you mix down is you take this desired signal, which is orange, amongst all of these interference here, and you mix it with an oscillator. Okay? First, you pre-select filter this to knock out the troublesome interference, but you still have interference in your band here. And that's this, which is much higher in power than your desired signal. You then mix this. Forgetting things. So, you actually have all this stuff here, but let's just focus on one of these things to make it simpler here. Okay, you then mix this with an oscillator. And again, if it's an ideal local oscillator, that's going to be just a delta function of energy. If I have a delta function of energy and I multiply these two signals together, what that's going to do is translate everything down to the difference frequency between these and this, and you'll get this in the end. Get these at a much lower frequency, which is now easier to process. You can then take a filter, which is much easier to do at low frequency, and knock out this interferer. Okay, so you're left with this, and you get pristine received signal. It could be voice, television, whatever it might be. Okay, this is the ideal case. If receivers really work this way, you know, our phones would be very cheap, they would consume very little power, etc. What really happens is you get the local oscillator not as a delta function, but you have that noise on it now. So you got a lot of signal at the frequency you want, and you now have some signal off of that frequency. This now, when mixed with this, will superimpose itself on top of this very large interferer. That amplifies all of this to a higher power, and so now even the noise from the tail of your spectrum can mask the signal you're trying to find here, and then no amount of filtering here is going to recover that signal. Now, in truth, if you do a CDMA or something, you could actually recover that signal just because of the autocorrelation that's going on there. But in the end, you know, most systems are like this, right? You need to get that phase noise low enough so that you can recover that signal. Okay, so why? How do we design against that phase noise? So let's go to some oscillator basics here. So this is going to be some really basic stuff. Again, I said the output of an oscillator is really just noise, amplified at a very specific frequency. Okay, so what does that mean? So let me describe that and how you might construct an oscillator. So to construct an oscillator, you have to start with a noise source, really. You will not have an oscillator without some kind of noise source there. And a physical resistor is a great noise source, right? It's got thermal noise in it. But you can model the noise in that physical resistor by a current noise generator or by a voltage noise generator. In this case, I've chosen to take this resistor, modeled by this current noise generator. Okay? And so that noise noise, right, I can look at in the frequency domain. If it's thermal noise, it's white noise. Or I could look at it in the time domain, in which case it's just some horrible, you know, fuzzy signal there. And I can think of the output of this, in this case, this is just the cross resistors being exactly the same. Right, that's what you get off of a resistor. To make an oscillator, what are you really doing? You're not doing some frequency selection around this. So you're actually adding to this resistor, which has its own noise here, some kind of tank circuit. Yes, in this case, I'll show it as an LC. But of course, this could also be a mechanical resonator, any type of peaked frequency response that you may be looking for. And so if I take this noise from this resistor and I pipe it through this LC, and I measure the voltage across this, right, first of all, this LC is going to have some kind of frequency shaping response that looks somewhat like this. The sharper this is, or the higher the Q this is, the sharper this will be. And the sharper that is, the smaller this bandwidth is, effectively. So that's sort of the half-power bandwidth, the 3 dB bandwidth of this. And in the end, what you get is now a noise spectrum that's not white, but that now is shaped by that filter spectrum. And if it's shaped by that filter spectrum, it now has a time constant associated with it. So now it becomes more deterministic. It's not just some garbled time domain signal coming out. It's a time domain signal that starts looking sinusoidal. I'm drawing a little too sinusoidal. But what's happening is that over this time span tau, which is equal to 1 over this bandwidth here, it actually looks a little deterministic, right? It's got almost a constant frequency, almost a constant amplitude. But outside of that tau for longer times, its amplitude and frequency are changing. And so just doing this filtering helps me get a more deterministic signal out of this. And the bandwidth of this filter, how sharp that bandwidth is, tells you what tau is going to be, because tau goes as 1 over the bandwidth. Okay, so what happens when we actually make an oscillator? This is not an oscillator yet. I've just put a tank circuit around this to shape that noise response. Now let's go ahead and make an oscillator. To make an oscillator, you put the active element in. You're using positive feedback. And in this case, to do that, I'm going to bring in a transconductor here. Now there's an amplifier hooked up as a transconductor. And I now put that in feedback around here. And so what that transconductor does is it actually simulates, and there's many ways to think of this, I'm just going to do it the whole simple way, it simulates a negative resistance. In this case, I'm looking at this in terms of conductance, not resistance, right? Resistance is 1 over conductance. And so this is a negative conductance that cancels out the actual real conductance, the positive conductance that you have in the tank circuit, right? Which is your noise source as well. So the noise source still stays there. But this cancels this out. If this cancels this out, what happens is you have very little loss in this system. That means the Q jumps up and becomes enormous. Okay, so whatever Q I started up with here, because I put this in and it canceled out that conductance there, this Q goes up by pretty much omega naught C over G total. G total is now very close to zero, which means this has been amplified by something like 10 to the 11th, 10 to the 15th or so. The Q has gone up that much. So if you think of an effective Q, so I'll call it effective Q, cut a line width or whatever you want, it's now taken that band and made it extremely sharp by 10 to the 11th to 10 to the 15th times. Okay, if it's extremely sharp, now that bandwidth is extremely small, which means 1 over that bandwidth, right, which is our tau, is now extremely long. That's what makes the stable oscillator now. Okay, so that tau now becomes something, because the tank Q went from 10,000 to 10 to the 15th, and those are real values of what really happens in this, actually. If you think of it in terms of this, there's many different ways to think of an oscillator. This is, I think, the nicest way to describe it as quickly as possible here. And so, right, this very thin bandwidth here is shaping the noise. Now my tau becomes 200 gains, okay, which means that that frequency, that amplitude, is not changing significantly over 200 days, which means it's an extremely stable output. And that's why I'm saying the output of an oscillator is really just noise, right, amplified and filtered by a very sharp spectrum, where that sharp spectrum was created by the positive feedback. Okay? That really, in a nutshell, is what an oscillator is. And it's a very simple way of thinking of it, but it all works out, right? You can derive these equations. equations from this. You can derive, you know, all of the phase noise equations off of this. And so we start talking about phase noise, well, what we're really plotting is the ratio of the noise, the sideband noise, the offset noise, and where the offset here is FM from the center frequency F0, divided by the carrier power, which is really just amplified noise, but we're treating that as our deterministic signal. Again, if you plot that versus the frequency offset from the carrier, you see something like this typically with phase noise. So I don't have all the regions. There's actually a lot of regions of phase noise here, but you get maybe a 1 over F cubed region there that's caused oftentimes by an aliased 1 over F noise. So that's where nonlinearities come in to create that noise. You have your 1 over F squared noise, which is the noise that is sort of well by Mason's equation, any way you want to derive that. And then you've got, you know, you also have a 1 over F portion there that I'm not identifying, but then you've got your white noise coming off of this and phase noise. Now, I'm also saying that the phase noise is half the total output noise. That's a hand wave on my part. It really isn't, right? You can go much more accurately, and it's approximately half of that noise. And it's approximately just for certain types of waveforms you get out there, things like ISF functions you can assign to these things that will give you a better breakdown of how much is amplitude noise, how much is phase noise. That's for Craig Nelson to get into. Maybe he got into that. That's right. I see some nods, and I see somebody see both types of noise. So maybe some people just didn't see the whole Craig Nelson presentation. Yeah, so I'm not going to steal any of Craig Nelson's thunder. I can't. Right? He knows much more about this than me, I'm sure. But in the end, you can derive the phase noise expressions just for this oscillator right here, just using brute force circuit design and knowledge of noise, if you've taken those courses. And so this is an example that Steyer did in 1995. Steyer is just reinventing the wheel because this stuff, of course, was done a long, long time ago of that sort. But you can come up with equations here that start to look like Leeson's equation, and eventually, if you just massage them and, you know, a little bit of algebra, they do look like Leeson's equation in the end. And here is, I guess, still even approximate Leeson's equation, right? So there's a 1 plus part of this that shouldn't do the white noise portion here, but at least the 1 over F squared part of this thing, this equation describes. You can see what it depends on. It depends, yes, on the thermal noise that you have there. It'll depend also on your transistor noise factor that will multiply this thermal noise. And I guess if I'm showing you this equation, it depends on how much power you have circulating in the loop of your oscillator. That's this P naught. It depends very strongly on your Q. So again, the higher that Q, the lower the noise you're going to have in this oscillator, the more stable this oscillator will be against things like temperature shifts and other things that can do long-term shifts. The high Q reduces the close to carrier phase noise, so that's in here. High power circulating through the loop reduces both the near and far from carrier phase noise. Okay? And a lot of this is still a very simplistic picture that I'm doing, where you can get much more detail. Again, I'm sure Craig did at that point. But what I want to do is now get into the oscillator part. So let's get into some of the MEMS parts of this. First, let's talk about, you know, the two types of oscillator domains you can think of. So one of them are high Q oscillators, right? This is where I would say the Qs are tens of thousands or so. That's the crystal oscillator. And in this case, a crystal oscillator, say at 10 megahertz or 13 megahertz, easily can get you phase noise at an offset 1 kilohertz from the carrier on the order of minus 140 dB signal. So they do a lot better than that, too. So it's extremely stable. The disadvantage of this is its large size, and it requires off-chip components. Now, for a time, people in the IC domain, well, not for a time, forever, they've been wanting to get rid of the quartz crystal. Right? Of course, they're unable to. Mainly because in ICs, you can either use inductor capacitor type resonators, which can maybe get you tank Qs on the order of 30, or you can use LC or ring oscillators, which can get you tank Qs on the order of 1 or so. And right away, you see that Q is too low, so you're not going to get good phase noise performance. If they expend a lot of power and have a lot of power circulating through the loop, you can actually meet GSM's far from carrier performance spec, which is minus 121 dBc at 600 kilohertz. Sometimes it's 1.2 megahertz in there, so that's not a difficult spec to get. But if you want to do better than that, you're not going to be able to do that really with just transistor technology. So what people do for a lot of these things is actually combine two oscillators. And so that's where a phase lock loop helps you in a big way. You can lock your very stable crystal-like oscillator, which has very little phase noise, together with this VCO, which might be based on some kind of tunable capacitor inductor network, often they are nowadays, which would have horrible phase noise. But you lock them together in the right places, and you borrow the stability of the crystal oscillator at close to carrier frequencies, but then borrow the stability of the LC oscillator, which has a lot more power, so can have much better far from carrier phase noise in the end, at that frequency, which is usually going to be hundreds of megahertz, gigahertz or so. So you get the best of both worlds here by basically locking this in a feedback loop, where it's a phase detector that gets these phases equal up to a certain bandwidth. Okay? So I sort of went through that a bit quickly, sort of on purpose, just to give you, the way that they're really making this. When they make MEMS-based oscillators, this is a good way also to tune the frequency. And so when you hear things like a fractional end synthesizer, so that's what a lot of MEMS-based oscillators are using, that actually is the Achilles heel of MEMS-based oscillators when you want to use them in something like communications. And that's why some of these oven-based control techniques, or TC, MEMS oscillators, temperature compensated MEMS oscillators, are better approaches, because they may be able to get rid of this synthesizer, the fractional end synthesizer, which suddenly gets you an oscillator that's good enough to do cell phone type communications. Okay? So now let's get into the actual, back to some of the technology here. We're working our way toward actually designing a MEMS-based oscillator and showing the benefits of this. So, MEMS-based resonators. So first of all, then you do have tunable capacitors and MEMS. Okay, they can get you Qs of 60. I'm just showing these to you, but I'm not going to use them anywhere in this because my conclusion is they're still no good. They're not high enough in Q, right? Also inductors, right? So you get MEMS-based inductors, and some of them can be really cool looking. They can use some really cool processes, right? So the way this inductor was made, you can see it's sort of like a solenoid inductor, right? It's field lines, magnetic field lines are going this way, not into the substrate. So you don't create those eddy currents in the substrate that, say, a planar spiral inductor does, which is what you usually get in an integrated circuit process. And therefore, you get much higher Q. And so the way this was made, you're using stress, right? So they actually allow this metal to curl up and then lock together to form these solenoids here. It's really cool technology. It was Xerox Park that did this. Only anyone uses it, right? Because for an oscillator, it can give you a nice oscillator, but not as good as what you can get from an actual vibrating MEMS resonator, right? So I think the bottom line is if you have something that can vibrate, that's going to have a much higher Q in the end. The losses that you get and the types of reactances you can get in mechanics are just such that the Qs are so much higher than you get in electronics, at least at room temperature. And so, there are a variety of vibrating MEMS resonators, and the beauty of MEMS is that it covers a huge dynamic range of frequency here. You've got stuff all the way down in the below kilohertz range, right, which you might need for some real-time clocks, for example, and I'm showing examples both in capacitive transduced and piezoelectric as well. You have sort of the HF range where a lot of the quartz oscillators are right now, HF, VHF, and that sort. So things like beams, and you can see both in the capacitive transduced and the piezoelectric type domains. And then finally up in the UHF range, where we're looking at gigahertz now, where you can look at capacitive, and again, piezoelectric here, where this thing was attempting to try to get as high Q as possible. So this is actually, I guess they call them low bars or something. They're like an H-bar type resonator that multiple lobes of resonance in there. And that allows them to get a much higher Q in the end than just a regular low nitride type resonator there. And so, again, I'm not going to focus on a lot of technologies in this room. My goal here is to talk about the oscillator design and how a MEMS resonator can really help in performance there. And so this is my technology slide. I'm showing all sorts of different technologies that can be used. What I'm going to do is focus in more on the types of resonators that people are really using, who are commercializing these things, and they happen to end up to be the capacitive transducers, and I'm going to get into the reasons why in just a little bit here. So first of all, what's the basic concept behind making a MEMS-based oscillator or a MEMS-based resonator? Well, the basic concept originally was just guitar strings, right? It's the same thing as a guitar string. I actually don't think I need to go through this with this audience, but I'm going to do it anyway. generators, you know, it's doing the tank circuit thing that we want, right? It's selecting a certain frequency, rejecting others, right? So it's a clean guitar string that you just stuck on your guitar. Maybe it's got a very high Q. And the Qs are guitar strings, and they can be up in the 500 or 700. They can be that high, actually. But if it's low Q, you've played it a long time, so your coils and stuff are on that string, then it's low Q, right? So that's the gray right here. So it's a wider response there. Now, the frequency of these resonators, it's generally, it's mechanical resonator, stiffness divided by mass. And so the stiffness and mass of the guitar string are such that that frequency is 110 hertz. Now, given that this goes as 1 over mass, it makes sense that if you make this smaller, you can more easily make these higher frequencies. So there's where some of the first MEMS resonators targeted for these types of oscillators came around, basically making guitar strings. And so, clamped at both ends. Now, a clamped condition rather than a simple, which most guitar strings are here. Instead of steel made or nickel made out of the polycrystalline silicon material, 2 microns thick, maybe 8 microns wide, 40 microns long, would give a frequency on the order of 8.5 megahertz when you account for the fact that the frequency is being pulled by an electrostatic stiffness, electrical stiffness I'll talk about in a second. But right away, pretty nice performance in vacuum here. So a Q of 8,000 at this frequency. The air Q drops to 50 for this structure because it's such a small structure. It has so little energy per cycle that it expends a significant fraction of its own internal energy just to push around the zero moment. It's like you and I try to move around in a swimming pool. And so it loses Q in air. Okay, it has to be in vacuum in order to get the high Q. That was thought to be one of the biggest drawbacks to MEMS when all of this began. And so a lot of this was beginning in the late 1990s or so. Those are times when I was talking to companies interested in doing this, and so they included so analog devices was one of them, TI was one of them, Maxim was one of them. There were a whole bunch of people gearing up to look at this technology, and the things that they were complaining about were the need to vacuum package. The other thing they were complaining about was the aging and the temperature stability. That was very legitimate. Both of those very legitimate. Okay? And so this was their problem with the vacuum package. You needed the vacuum to get the IQ. Nowadays, it almost doesn't matter because people understand that to get the aging that you need to be in vacuum, you need to be in some kind of pristine environment. So the package, it comes no matter what. Okay, looking more closely at this device, instead of stiffness over mass, you reduce that mass, you can get down to 10 to the minus 13, even smaller than that. And then it also depends on the materials and the Young's modulus and density. The way that you operate these capacitive gap transduced structures is you would first put a voltage on the structure, really just putting charge on it. There's no path for the charge to move. There's no current flowing here. There's no power consumption. It's still a passive device. But the voltage that you put on that sort of combines with the AC voltage that goes into an electrode underneath and creating those electric fields really forces this into motion. And in the end, the force is amplified by the DC bias. So you want that DC bias to be large if you want a strong force here. So this thing will vibrate. Right? That vibration really creates a time-varying capacitor across which you have this voltage. Okay? And so it's the VP times DC dt part of that current equation that gives you that output current. And so that, when you sweep its frequency across a range, will trace out your bandpass bicoil. It's going to be a very high Q one because it's based on a mechanical resonance here. And the other nice thing about this capacitive gap transduction that people take advantage of is you can turn it on and off at will. Right? You're going to get no output current on this here if you make that DC bias 0 volts. Right? So you can switch that response on and off. So it's not only a resonator, it's also a switch at the same time. It's almost like a transistor and resonator in one device. That is a useful thing for applications, I guess. I'm not going to say a lot about. But the other thing I can say about this is that, and this could be good, it could be bad, depending on what you're looking for. But the frequency of this thing depends on this voltage. It also depends on this gap. So in fact, you can derive what happens here. I guess I can sort of add one of this. But if I put a voltage across this beam and its electrode, I'm creating electric fields across this. And if that beam then moves closer to that electrode, those fields get stronger because the distance gets smaller. What does that mean? That means that those fields are actually helping me push that beam down toward the substrate. Okay? That force that's helping is in phase with me trying to push that down to the substrate. Okay, it's also proportional as well. And so it's basically a stiffness. So that's an electrical stiffness again that helps me. Right? The mechanical stiffness usually impedes me. This electrical stiffness helps me. And so it's a negative electrical stiffness. Okay, so there's a negative stiffness that subtracts from the mechanical stiffness in the frequency equation. And that negative stiffness depends on these fields, so it depends on the voltage, the square of this voltage. It also depends on that gap, so it depends on the initial gap, which I'm calling D here, for the third power. It also depends on other, you know, the permittivity, which is air in this case, and the air overlap area. But what this allows you to do now is tune the frequency of this device by changing that DC bias. Okay, that's great if you want a tunable oscillator or a tunable filter. But it's not so great if you're looking for something very stable. Okay, so that's something you have to fight in the side time fights, the adversarial of the fight, in order to get very stable oscillators. But at the same time, it's something that maybe they use to do frequency control for temperature compensation. Okay, so it's both plus and minus when you're designing your oscillator. It's a cool feature on these types of devices. You can do even more with these devices, and maybe I'll skip through this because I guess I should watch timer here. Let me skip through a few things here. I'm going to be listening too much on some of these things. So, yes. So metal has some issues because the jury's not out on that, right? We actually are still working on metal right now to see if we can get this guy's polysilicon. But metals, right, they have creep, and so they will relax and stress over time. They also have, I would say, more their dissipation mechanisms versus the phonon-phonon interactions and that sort of thing in metal. It naturally gives them, naturally, I don't want to use that word necessarily, but it gives them a lower Q in the end. So if I took a gold structure, for example, the Q of that gold structure might be on the order of 300 or so. Whereas in polysilicon, I might be able to get 10,000, actually 200,000 or above has been shown in polysilicon. But some metals, if you alloy the metals, and if you work them a bit, you actually get their Qs up to 20,000, for example. So that's possible as well. So I don't want to put the kiss of death on metal, but people don't trust it, mainly because it is lower Q. It does have some creep issues. But some of that might be solvable through alloying. In fact, in the good old days, right, it was nickel cobalt type alloys that competed with quartz. It lost in the end, but it actually was good enough to compete. And so the jury's not out on that. We actually do research to try to get metals to work better for other types of devices. We're still looking for good cues and good frequencies. Okay, let me skip through some of this. This is basically just saying that I can make this device a mixer and all sorts of things at the same time. Okay, but let's get back to this resonator here. And let's complain about it a little bit. Okay, so it's a nice resonator. It's on a guitar string right here. It's clamped at both ends. It's getting a respectable Q in this case. This one's an 8,000 in vacuum at this point. But suppose I wanted to go to higher frequency. And so one way I might want to do that is take this resonator element. Maybe we start at 130, right? And so I'm not that bad off. Okay. I don't have to skip too much, but the thing that I skipped, that's fine to skip it. That wasn't that important, you know. But in this thing right here, so I've got these anchors on this device. So to keep this up at 70 megahertz, if I don't change the thickness, I'm going to have to shrink this down to what I said, written down here, which is 14 microns, to get to 70 megahertz from 40. So go from 40 to 14. Takes you from that almost 10 megahertz to this 70 megahertz here. But what happens is your Q drops from that 8,000 to 300. And even in vacuum, what's happening here is you got an anchor loss mechanism. So basically, those anchors on this beam, right, which is going up and down, the beam's going up and down, so it's pushing on those anchors, and those anchors are now radiating energy into your substrate. And that energy is then being lost at some interface cells, and maybe in a package interface or so. And that then dominates the Q of this type of resonator here. Okay, so that's like a substrate dissipation mechanism. It's like the dissipation mechanism that prevents us from using inductors, for example, for getting very high Q stuff, spiral inductors, because the magnetic fields go into the substrate, that creates a substrate, any currents that lower their Q. In this case, you can think of a mechanical dissipation mechanism. But this is the beauty of mechanics versus electronics. In mechanics, we have so much flexibility to change our geometry, maybe even use a mechanical circuit or something. In this case, if it's our anchors that are giving us the problem, just get rid of the anchors. Okay, so how do you get rid of the anchors? Well, one clever way of doing this is instead of using a clamped beam, use a free beam, like this right here. And so this thing actually will animate, but it won't animate probably on this computer. I'm going to try something that maybe I shouldn't and get out of this. Yes, hopefully this won't run. No, it won't. Anyway, that would have shown you the mode shape of this. I'm trying one more thing. Yes, it won't run. This does not want to do the first. Here it goes. Oh, you don't see anything there. Alright, that was a bad thing I did. Let me see if I can recover here. I shouldn't be able to. All it takes is this, but yeah, unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to show you the motion, but you can kind of see it. Right? So you can see the beam is moving. Its endpoints are moving. One like this, where the endpoints are fixed by the anchors. Right? So its endpoints are moving. It's free. It's moving up and down. So the support mechanism is right here. So these beams coming out there. So the beauty of this, right, where this thing moves up and down. Oh, my laser pointer's coming. So, right, you can see this moving up, you can see the center moving down, but you can see where it's being supported by these beams here. These are the supports. That's the actual resonator. These are just supports going to anchors up here. And so, the beauty of this is these supports are at locations where if you look at this mode shape, it would be much easier to look at if this were moving. But there are points where the mode shape is such that you don't get any transverse motion. It's not going up and down there. Right? So you're not going to lose any of that energy to the substrate because there's no motion there. Now there is torsional motion there. Right? So it's twisting around that. But the cleverness here is to design these supporting beams, right? To recognize that this is a high enough frequency, and this is at 92 megahertz, that the mechanics now are not lumped elements. They are transmission lines. So these are mechanical transmission lines. You can now design these to be quarter wavelength, half wavelength. They get all those same benefits that if you know coax design or waveguide design, all the same benefits from that design. So these are actually designed, the supporting beams, to be a quarter wavelength, quarter torsional wavelength at the frequency of this resonator here. But what that does, it sort of takes the infinite acoustic impedance at the anchor and transforms that to zero impedance seen by the resonator. So, even though it is supported by physical structures, because of clever quarter wavelength design, this beam feels like it's virtually levitated. It's got no anchors, right? Really clever stuff mechanically. And in the end, the Q has been measured as high as 15,000 at this 92 megahertz. So, we're covering that Q completely. Same beam design. Really, just a beam that's exactly the same frequency as this here, except changing the anchors in such a way that we can recover that Q. It's the beauty of MEMS, is that you can do that sort of thing. And that, in fact, is what DeSera did. And so this is DeSera's resonator. Okay, so right, everything's in the package. And there was a question about how small this could be. So there it is. Are you going to put this in a plastic package above all of this stuff? You can see the bond wires coming between the package cap above the MEMS die and then the transistors underneath this here. But this is approximately the resonator. This actually is not the resonator being used. It used to be that I would not talk about the resonator, but I guess I will now. The difference now is that it's a much fatter resonator. Right? This resonator looks like a beam. The Sarah's resonator actually looks more like a square plate, or even a more rectangle going in this direction. And the Sarah actually does not use the quarter wavelength supports, because they help, but they're not really necessary. That torsional loss is not that big. They get stuck at Qs of 30,000 or more, but without having to make these quarter wavelengths long. But that's their basic resonator there. I guess this is a 9,000 Q one there. It's just showing that you can get that type of Q out of things. So the high Q and low drift, if it has low drift, we'll talk about that later on, then make possible a very stable low power time keeper, a smaller size, lower cost, because you can make many more of these per wafer, and as I'll say, lower power consumption for these types of devices. Okay, and so let me talk about power consumption as we get to higher frequencies here. So let's now talk about, that was HF range, high frequencies. The definition of HF is 3 megahertz to 30 megahertz. And VHF is 30 megahertz to 300. And so I guess I'm sort of skipping that previous one was HF and VHF. Let's now talk about UHF getting up to gigahertz frequencies. So one way you do that is continue to scale. And that's what physicists did in the beginning. So Michael Rukas had been doing some work in this area. He's a physicist from Caltech. And he constructed resonators in silicon carbide. He didn't have a good way to actuate them, so their performance actually wasn't that great initially, but he was able to make resonators up in the gigahertz range. And you can see some of the sizes. Right? This is 1 micron, so this thing's a little over a micron long, but its width and thickness dimensions were in the nanometer scale. This is when the nano was big, right? So nanomechanics and things, so that people were doing things like this here. So you can make an oscillator out of this, supposedly, but you don't have a lot of coupling going into this. Yeah, and the other problems with going too small is now even molecules, the difference in the absorption and desorption rates of molecules onto the surface of the structure can significantly change the mass, such that now you have a noise mechanism just through absorption and desorption of molecules on this thing, gas molecules. Right? You don't really want to have to put up with that. Now, the other thing is temperature fluctuation. There's a whole host of things that go wrong when you become too small. Not that you shouldn't ever try to become too small, I bet you could be solved. Maybe a ring or circuits like that. But it's just easier to tackle at higher frequencies with different geometries. And so one really nice geometry that people have looked at is the disk geometry. Okay, so this is the resonance of disk, supported and centered by stems, sort of like a mushroom. Or if you haven't seen a stem, I think mushroom in this case. And now surrounded by electrodes that have tiny gaps between the electrode and the disk. So these tiny gaps initially were on the order of 100 nanometers. And then 80 nanometers. Now they're down to 13 nanometers. And I'll show some of that stuff. And you want that gap to keep going smaller and smaller because that makes your transduction a lot stronger. Okay, so I can do the exact same thing I did with the beam, right? Talking about stiffness and mass, shrinking mass down, material makes sense. But in the end, this is just a different bone shape. And so this is a sort of more of a bone shape where the disk is sort of expanding and contracting, as you're seeing right here, sort of like a breathing bone shape. And this turns out to be a great high-key motion, because you think of it, the anchor is at the very center. You have very little motion at the very center of this device, so very little energy loss onto the substrate in this case. Same kind of thing, you're getting a time-varying capacitor here. And so, exactly the same stuff, right? Current coming out of that time-varying capacitor, I can shut this off by just putting 0 volts on it instead of some DC bias voltage on it. Okay? And so that now is just resonator zone, the dimensions of this, for example, this radius to get a gigahertz now, is going to be on the order of 2.4 microns in polysilicon. That's a gigahertz. A diamond is even larger than that. And so you can derive all sorts of equations to get the exact frequency of this. And you can use a bunch of hairy equations with Bessel functions and that sort. You know, you can just look at, people have looked at these a long time ago, in the 50s and 60s. And that's all we did, right? We just looked up some of those papers where people were using these mainly for mechanical filters and that sort of thing in the past. And, you know, all of this boils down sort of to a simplified equation here where you can see that it's the lateral dimension that sets the frequency. That is huge, right? That's huge because that means you can put many different frequencies on the same chip. That's something you cannot do with an FBAR and that you cannot do with quartz crystals, right? But this is the big thing about MEMS as well. So a lot of the piezoelectric MEMS are also trying to take advantage of this as well. It's a lateral dimension, so it's a CAD layout that allows you to specify the frequency of your resonator. And especially communications, if you open up your phone, how many filters do you think you'll see in that phone now? Why is Broadcom making so much money? Well, that's 30 to 50 filters in your phone now. That number has just skyrocketed. And if you can put all 30, 50 plus filters on a single chip, and sell it for the same price as 30 or 50 filters, you make even more money. Right? So, for filters. Yeah, so we're not going to talk about filters in this in this tutorial here, but you actually can address that problem because you're now looking at multiple filters. Right, so if you can, you have to change your standard a bit. This is a long discussion, actually. It's, you know, I'm an evangelist for this sort of thing, but you know, when you're going to the future, like into 5G, for example, 5G is less cellular than more IoT sensors and that sort of thing, where power becomes premium. And in that case, you want the narrow bands to get the lower power. You don't need those large bands for wireless. This is a long discussion, so let me stop myself from getting into it here. I'm just sort of continue with some of this right here. But, you know, beyond this, right, you can also propose models for all of these things, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on these. These are models where you're basically taking the energy of the structure, like it's kinetic energy, dividing it by one half of velocity to get the equivalent mass of this thing. Doing an equivalent mass, stiffness, and damping on this thing. These are typical values you get at 150 megahertz for a disk like this. And then, you know, you can convert all of these mechanical circuit elements into equivalent electrical circuit elements at 150 megahertz. These are some reasonable values you can get. And not 50 ohms or something, but 1.3 kilo-ohms. And then still you can make an oscillator with at 150 megahertz. But this is going to be a problem as we start talking about even higher frequencies here. We'll address that problem. But before addressing it, let's just think about what's happening here with that impedance, right? When you're operating this resonator at resonance, what's happening is it's inductive, its reactive components are canceling one another. We're left with just the motional resistance. So in the end, when you're designing an oscillator, you're concerned maybe mostly with that motional resistance. And the motional resistance, when you expand out this equation right here, I know I'm going through this fairly quickly here, but here's where I'll slow down a bit. It depends on, among other things, the gap spacing between the electrode and the resonator to the fourth power. Okay, so when I say that the gaps right now are 100 nanometers, we made them 10 nanometers, take 10 to the fourth, and that's how much you want. Motional resistance changes. It's a huge change. Right? So just scaling that gap transform this from a resonator that's unusable to one you can put in any oscillator with current CMOS transistor technology. Yes, in the back. You care a lot about controlling the sidewalls. That's the secret to the whole thing, actually. I haven't even shown the process technology for this, and I will a little later on. And so let me address that a little later on after I show the process technology. Power handling also, yeah, so as this gap gets smaller because it's fourth power, right, you're actually getting a hell of a lot more current coming through this as well. So to get the same current, you have to move less. Right? So even though that gap is smaller, to get the same, actually even more current, you're still moving less. Right? So you're right about power handling. This gets nonlinear. It starts moving too much if you're 10 nanometers. But it turns out that it kind of supports and scales well and supports itself. Now you have to do a little bit more stuff here. You might want to array these things as well. I'll talk about arrays at the same time. But that's a good question as well. There's a lot of problems with that gap. This is another one. Go ahead. Yes. Exactly. Package stress for packaging for gaps. And so I guess how am I going to answer that one? Let me answer it this way. We've made filters that are much more complex than these oscillators I'm about to talk about. And the filters even worse because filters take a number of these resonators and they link them with links. And so there are actually some pretty big structures with these small gaps. There is a solution to that. I'm not going to say what it is yet, though. But so you actually can solve that problem. But, you know, there's all sorts of issues with that small gap, the 13 nanometer gap, right? You can think of contamination. Passenger forces. Right? There are even people that were saying that if you put too large a voltage across that, you're going to get some kind of breakdown. I'm not sure how, because you're in vacuum, right? Even if you weren't in vacuum, there'd be a few molecules through that, right? So if there's a sharp point, maybe you can concentrate. Yeah. So there's issues with the gap. Right? The 13 nanometer gap was just done very recently. I'll show those results actually here. But again, yeah, just does it need to be 13 nanometers? I think it can be. But I'm a university professor, right? So I've also started a company, I suppose, but then everyone starts with nanometer gaps. But you know, there'll be a lot of complaints about gaps. But just let me say, if you go from 100 nanometers to 10 nanometers, world of difference in coupling strength and in motional resistance. Okay, and then the other things you can change are things like the DC bias. Raise the DC bias, you know, that also will reduce the emotional resistance as well. You can see these things here. So these are the things you can play with to control your emotional resistance. And again, I have slides that show some of this, but here, there's an example for a disc with a 6.5 micron diameter. That's going to be 850 megahertz. And you can see this is sort of plotting diameter, and on this plot here is emotional resistance versus frequency in that case. I guess the most more important thing to look at was just what resistance can you get from the scale. It goes up to about 9 kilohms. And that's because the voltage is being used are kind of high, like 30 volts, 10 volts, 30 volts or so. But this is with a gap of 50 nanometers. This is with a gap of 25 nanometers here. You know, like 10 nanometers, I would say these are pretty reasonable. 50 nanometers, we've got a pretty good yield with. You know, you can see that when you get to 25 nanometers and 30 volts, if you can sustain 30 volts across 20 nanometers, 25 nanometers, you can see that dropping below a kilowatt right there in emotional resistance. So this really does, you get a lot of gain if you can make those gaps a lot smaller. And if you're willing to play with those gaps, I do understand all the concern about the gaps, but I will admit that's not proven out. Right? We just got these gaps very recently. Okay? But if these gaps prove out, I don't think PSO lets you compete with this in terms of Q and transducer strength. I haven't even told you the KQ squared yet. They're going to be some amazing numbers. Yes? Let me show you in just a second here. That's the very next slide. So here we go. If the next slide wants to come. This thing is frozen. Microsoft PowerPoint is not responding. Restart the program. Maybe an anticipated question. Just didn't want to answer or something like that. I'm going to have to restart this here. Or I can wait for the program to respond. Do I dare do that? It's spinning. Never do that, someone said. No, there it is. It worked. Okay. So here it is. This is that mode shape we're looking at here. And you can see that, you know, this is the second radial contour mode in diamond. So I switched materials here to CVD diamond. But here you can see at 1.5 gigahertz, you're getting a Q of about 11,000 in vacuum. The interesting thing, the Q is still 10,000 in air. And that's because now you've got a device that has much more stiffness. So it's a lot more energy per cycle. It doesn't care as much about the air molecules. Okay, so it retains Qs up to this 10,000, even 12,000 we measure. It won't go beyond that. Right? If you want 50,000, you're going to have to keep it in vacuum for that. Okay, but respectable Qs, I'm going to show even higher Qs in a second with a better resonator. But just for now, how does the structure make? So this thing actually had a gap of 80 nanometers between the electron and the structure. So here's the fabrication process for this. So we start with a silicon substrate. We put down that isolation oxide and then isolation nitride that were shown at the beginning of this whole thing. We then put down our polysilicon interconnect and pattern. Right? This is dope polysilicon. Then put down an oxide. So far, it's exactly the same process that you saw before. This is usually a thinner oxide. Before it was 2 microns. Now this is about 500 nanometers, so half a micron there. Then you put down your structural material. It's going to be polysilicon. In this case, I'm showing polydiamond in this case. You then put down a hard mask so that you can pattern the structural materials. It's relatively thick structural material, 2 or 3 microns is what you want, usually here. So you pattern first the hard mask using lithography and etching, right, some oxide there. Then you etch the polydiamond. Okay? And I'm not going to say anything about how to deposit the polydiamond. I still have time to do that, but you can ask me questions. It's no more difficult than depositing polysilicon. It's not like diamond, it's very expensive, right? This is more like carbon-like diamonds. So it costs about the same to put it down. But it's a much better material. Because if you do the analyses on its loss mechanisms, phonon, etc., diamond will give you the highest Qs. So you notice that in this etch here, we've etched not only the sidewalls of the disk, these are the sides of the disk, but also etched the anchor point, the stem of this. That's very important because you want the stem exactly in the center of this disk. Because if it's exactly the center, you're going to get the least amount of energy loss to the substrate. Okay, at this point then, you go ahead and you put down your sacrificial sidewall spacer that defines your gap. This is that 8 nanometer gap. All these gaps that I'm going to talk about, down to 13 nanometers, is done by a sidewall sacrificial spacer. It's not etching that creates them. It's a spacer technique. Okay, and so after this, right, you etch, put photoresist around this so they can access the stem to etch down because you want to make contact to the polysilicon underneath here. Or else at the same time etching for the electrons on the sides here. Remove that photoresist, put down a blanket deposition of polysilicon. The polysilicon is generally conformal, so it's going to fill this stem here with polysilicon. The fact that you have a different material in your stem as your structure also helps because that will reflect the energy back into the structure, which also contributes to your high quality factor. The last step here is to pattern your electron material. So you have electrons around this dip in an HF. Okay, so now you have your disk that has electrons around it. So that these sturdy polysilicon electrons are very sturdy because they're curved. Right? Just like your Volkswagen cars and that sort of thing, those commercials that bring about the curvature making that stronger. Exactly the same thing here. You've got a micromechanical disk structure this time in diamond. You have tiny gaps here. So I guess what I created is 50 nanometer gaps. I should have changed that to 13 nanometers now. And finally, you have a stem that's exactly in the center of this structure, which really maximizes its Q. Now, on the question about getting this gap smaller, I'm not going to actually say more about the process there, but it is absolutely essential that before you put down that sacrificial sidewall spacer, that this sidewall be as flat as possible. So if you have things like disparities coming out of this, you will not get your 13 nanometer gaps. And so it's a special recipe. We haven't done it in diamond, I should say. But in polysilicon, it's a special recipe to get that as smooth as possible. It's not that special, so it's obvious stuff, right? Just don't use chlorine. If it's a chlorine, hydrogen bromide etch, don't use too much chlorine in the beginning. Keep the HBR up. But at the end, you can't use the HBR because you're going to get grass on it, and it's a return to the chlorine in that case. That gives you a very smooth sidewall that can get you that 13 nanometer gap. And the yield on that gap wasn't bad. It wasn't as good as you know, 40 nanometer stuff and 8 nanometer stuff. But 13 nanometer yielded okay to the point where I'm going to show you some measured results in just a second here. Yes? So the energy is stored in the structure. Maybe the better question is, how's the energy lost? And so the energy, one of the biggest loss mechanisms is through this anchor to the substrate. So some of those vibrations, right? You want all the vibrations to stay in the structure itself. But if you've got something holding it up that's going to allow some of that vibration to go into the substrate, you're losing that energy. The other portion where you're losing the energy are just in the microstructure of the material itself. Right, so you've got interactions between the photons. So, for example, if I have this atom here that moved here while it was vibrating, if it moves back and it doesn't end up in exactly the same place, that's a hysteresis, and that's energy loss right there. So, other things like thermoelastic damping, which is less of a problem for this type of resonator, that's where, say, if you had something that contorted like this, this is in compression, that's in tension, this heats up, then cools down, you get that heat flow. That's energy loss there. And so it gets down to a lot of details on energy loss. What determines that Q? The easiest way to answer is just it's anchor design, anchor design, anchor design, and use the right material for high frequency. Diamond is the best. Okay. Yes? We have to some extent, so. We've actually made stems that are hollow. Okay? And so if you make a hollow stem in here, you will get even higher Q. So that tells you, I don't know if that answers that question. It actually doesn't, right? Because you have both mechanisms helping you. But we've done some calculations on acoustic mismatch. I won't say that we understand everything yet, right? This is a very difficult problem to try to decipher here. Whether it's the device, the loss of the phone on, or whether it's completely the anchor. But we have seen evidence of just changing the anchors, that a lot of it is the anchor still. For this structure, it's still the anchors, and we're not able to contain all that energy just with that mismatch. Yes? Is more in polysilicon? So in polysilicon, it's lower, definitely. And so that gigahertz, 1.5 gigahertz, that's actually not as high as diamond should be able to get. I'm trying to remember what polysilicon gives us. We haven't done it in a while, maybe 20,000-30,000 or so. But then we've seen something like that, but now I have to remember that frequency. Definitely at 224 megahertz, that was 20,000 is what we're getting. But I don't think that's the highest that we've gotten there. Okay, so back to this. That was the process that achieved this. And this is kind of nice in itself. But there is better geometries you can use. So here is a better, here's a better geometry. Okay, so this is no longer a disk. This is actually a ring. Okay, this is also made in diamond. You can tell because it's dark, right? So it's more diamond-like carbon. So it's dark in here. You can see the electrodes around. This is the electrodes even on the inside. But this is now a spoke-supported ring. So it's like a spoke-supporting, you know, bicycle wheel. Like a spoke's going in the center. So the important thing is it's anchored in the center again, right? Where there's very little motion. And if there is any forces that are coming in on both sides, they cancel going in the center support. That's the secret to a lot of high Q psi times main resonator at the higher frequencies is anchored in the center, right? These things are anchored in the center. Very important there. But this is now a ring. And you can see this performance. And this is 900 megahertz. So you know it's targeting something like GSM. Right, but this is a Q of 77,000 coming out of this diamond. That is incredibly high. Right? I think that's the highest to date for anything this small one chip at room temperature. I'm saying all these things on top of it. But it's an unbelievably high Q. It's almost like SLC resonators that they're using, Poseidon resonators, that are used for some of the best readers around. There's a question. Yeah, okay. No, this is the real emotional resistance. Before your question, I was going to point this out as a major problem. Right? So I'm boasting about the Q. But emotional resistance this high will preclude you from designing an oscillator. Yes? Parameters. No, the equivalent C is really low, but the equivalent L is enormous. Yeah. Right, yeah. No, you're absolutely correct. And so if you're thinking of KT squared, which is equal to CX over C naught, it's absolutely horrible for this. Right? Part of the reason is that it's at this high a frequency, and it's in diamond, which is very stiff, and the gap is only still 75 nanometers. The world will change enormously when you take this down to 40 nanometers, when you take it down to 20 nanometers, when you take it down to 10. Okay? So this disappears. We haven't done it yet for this frequency. But at least the theory says it disappears. It comes down to 50 or less. Right? With reasonable DC biases. So that's where that gap spacing really gets you. You get this Q plus a KT squared that's very strong. But on top of that, you can get the small gaps. But those are ifs. Right. We do have the small gaps at lower frequency, but in diamond at this frequency, not yet. That's something definitely being worked on right now. You go even higher. So this is the basic ring here. I guess just the obligatory mode shape to show how it's... The ring is not expanding and contracting uniformly. It's sort of a breathing mode over the width of the structure. So the mode that we're using is the one where this expands and contracts over its width. And so the width, which is R0 minus RI, we're close to the radii, that's what decides the frequency of this thing. And, same kind of thing. You get this spectrum here. I guess this is the higher frequency. This is now almost 3 gigahertz. And you have a Q of 42,000 still at 3 gigahertz. So phenomenal performance here, but horrid emotional resistance. Okay, so what can you do about this emotional resistance? And again, to the fourth power that goes with gap. So let's take a little look at that right now. So first, let's take a look at transducers. If you have this resistance problem, how do you solve this? One way to do it will be piezoelectric. Right? Piezoelectric will give you the much stronger KT square. That's great for a lot of things. For oscillators, this Q of 2,900, which is actually very good for one of these piezoelectrics. This is one of John Lukopiasa's originals. When he was a student at UC Berkeley and Pisano. But this is really good performance for a piezoelectric with this Q in the order of 3,000. And you can see that the coupling is strong enough to get that 80 ohms. But again, that Q is 3,000. And that's not going to be the best oscillator if you're looking for performance there. So how do you go back and get that performance? Well, you can sort of compare these two technologies, right? So this is the capacitive gap technology. That, you know, even with a gap that's not that good, you can get phenomenal Qs. And this is another diamond resonator at disk at about almost 500 megahertz, 497, with a Q of 55,000, but again, huge oscillator resistance. They compare that to an almost equivalent piezoelectric ring here. And this is the D31 type piezoelectric, not an F-bar type. But this obviously has a much better, right, the resistance is 80 ohms, 473 megahertz, so that Q that you just saw. So you got two competing technologies, right? It's the capacitive gap where it doesn't have a strong enough electromechanical coupling, but it has great Q. And you've got piezoelectric that has great electromechanical coupling, but not very good Q. Turns out that in both of these, you can raise that piezoelectric Q. There are things you can do, combine it with other materials and little circuits, and that Q goes up. You do that a bit at the sacrifice of its coupling. Okay? And that's one approach you can take to get, you know, I guess, you know, what we really want, the holy grail is both high Q and high coupling at the same time. Right? And so this capacitive gap resonator, it's already got the high Q. You just need the high coupling. You need to think to yourself, what's easier to do? Raise your Q or help your coupling? But for me, 9 out of 10 times is going to be helping your coupling. There's a lot more things you can do there. And for this case, here's what you do. Right? That same resonator, same mode shape there, but this now plots out for a specific resonator with a radius of 2.8 microns and admittedly a generous DC bias of 40 volts here. If your gas spacing is 80 nanometers, that's going to give you a motion resistance of 2.7 kilovolts. That's because you might generous 40 volts DC bias there. Okay. I should have redone this with a 10 volt DC bias because it still would have looked good by the end of this. You know? But as you start scaling that gap, there's 40, there's 20, there's 10. I really should have used the smaller voltages here because that looks too good, but that's what the theory tells you. Okay. So the other question is, does theory work when you scale that gap? Right? This is, I mean, you're looking at 2.8 microns, and so there's the frequency about 862 megahertz. And look at that CX over C naught. That is KT squared. CX over C naught is the same as KT squared up to a certain percentage number. That's almost 20% there. Even with this 20 nanometer gap, it's at 2.1%. Now, again, there's a generous 40 volts going there. Can you put 40 volts across 10 nanometers? All sorts of questions there. But if you just do the theoretical analysis, the best transducer is the capacitive gap. Until I see something else, that is the best. And so these types of KT squares actually have already been demonstrated at the lower frequencies. And I guess that's, I took that slide out, and that was one point I wanted to make. The reason why it is capacitive gap transduced silicon resonators that have been the most successful in the MEMS-based oscillator world is just that. Right? Piezoelectric has no chance. This is being recorded, and I'm fine with it. The capacitive gap resonators, they have Qs on the order of 30,000 or higher. Right? If you get their gaps down to even 100 nanometers, those beam resonators have KT squares with CX over C naught of about 10 to 15%. There's no piezoelectric that compares with that, both Q and maybe KT square. But Q, no way. Right? So piezoelectric for oscillators, if it's piezoelectric alone, just doesn't make sense. Unless you combine it, say, with silicon. So these things that are hybrids of piezoelectric and silicon, those can make sense. Or you need something to boost your Q up there. But the best technology is just straight silicon with a small gap. But I would contend that side times gaps are not small enough. If they just made smaller gaps, boy, would they be able to do all sorts of things, right? Including maybe some of this stuff in high frequency, okay? So I've been talking about small gaps. They're real. Okay, so here's the type of resonator that we use the small gaps on. So this is now a wine glass disc shape, sort of expanding and contracting along orthogonal axes. This is a much better isolated bone shape. So you can see the Q there at 145,000. Some have been measured at 200,000 or so. Incredible Q. This is only 60 megahertz though. Okay, and this is what we apply the small gaps to. This is not small gaps, this is still 80 nanometers. Here's small gaps. Okay, so this is actually the same resonator, 32 micron radius. The gap spacing here is 13.2 nanometers. And you can ask how the heck do we know it's 13.2 nanometers. I'll show you in a second how you actually measure that. But now look at these DC bias voltages being used, 2 volts, 5 volts, and that sort of thing. It's actually now a case where it's the interconnect resistance, because we're using polysilicon interconnect, that dominates the resistance of this device. The actual resistance of this device, even at this 2.5 volts here, is on the order of 200 ohms. You go up to 5.5 volts, that's now 54 ohms. You keep increasing that voltage, that resistance drops to single-digit ohms. Yes? So you can push, if you want a number on that, I'm going to have to go through memory. You can easily calculate that. I will tell you that this is 60 megahertz, I suppose. But I will tell you, we're not looking at power applications for these things. So in my department, there's a guy named Seth Sanders who's sort of the power guru. And usually with power converters, you're using capacitors and inductors to store that energy while you're converting it. Right now, it's becoming much more interesting to use these. So that means enough power that it becomes even interesting for a DC-DC or some other type of power converter. And that's not just one device. You've got to make an array of them to get enough power, but watts of power possible with an array. Okay, I wish I could tell you the exact single device number, but all I've done was calculate the rest. Okay. But you can see these resistors getting small, right? So this gap spacing is real, right? This is not fake stuff anymore. And just maybe 6 months from now, you're going to see 10 nanometer gaps with 800 megahertz or that sort of thing. So that's just going to change the landscape. You will then have KT squared and capacitive gap that will be the strongest around, provided we can get large enough voltages across it. And this will just keep getting better. This is like CMOS, right? As things scale, things keep getting better. If I could say something like CMOS, you know I'm saying something pretty powerful there, right? So, well, people said the same thing with CMOS, right? So 1989, CMOS was supposed to end. It was supposed to be gallium arsenide. Didn't happen. But it's still supposed to end. It's not happening. So it does depend on how big the market is. Understand? This can't come out with a lot of product. Well, Phil, it could be very big. Yeah, it could be enormous, right? Unless someone is able to figure out how to get rid of the filters, which is what the IFCS people were trying to do for the longest time, right? So far, they've lost that bet. I will never say anyone's won, right? It's always back and forth, right? But it looks pretty good for this type of technology. I'm focusing on the capacitive gap, but I will also say you could do all this in piezoelectric, too. Maybe not the Q, but a lot of the science I'll talk about in piezoelectric will work as well. I just think capacitive gap is better. It's been proven over time, but I think piezoelectric you can do it, too. Yes? Yes? Because we have polysilicon interconnect. Yes. That's all you have to do is use metal. But in our case, how do you get that metal down? I mean, there's issues, right? Metal after the polysilicon, you put it in HF, you get galvanic effects. We've solved that now, so we can't actually go to metal at this point. But sometimes it's just easier to do it in polysilicon because it's a process we know why. The next process is you might see more metal there to get rid of that effect. The other thing we do is make very thick polysilicon interconnect. That can help too. This interconnect was not thick enough. All right, so that's backwards. Okay, so more on this gap space. This is how we tell that it's 13.2 nanometers. we basically measure frequency versus voltage, the DC bias voltage, and you curve fit this with that gap spacing. So this curve fits with that 13.2 nanometers is what it comes down to. And we can't measure that any other way. Well, there's probably other ways to do it, but this is the most convenient way to do it. This is just more, you know, show-off stuff showing just what 13.2 nanometers can do versus something bigger there. And you know, electromechanical coupling, and you can see that showing the skyrocket pretty quickly there. But now, finally, let's get to oscillator design.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
We're almost done, aren't we? Well, you got aging and drift stuff in your... What do you want to see? Aging and drift versus oscillator design. You want to see oscillator design. Okay, so let's talk about oscillator design. And this is probably the most important thing to look at. Then aging and drift. Okay, we'll go as long as you want, actually. But we'll be kicked out of here eventually. So here's a nice oscillator using one of these wine glass discs. Okay, so you've got, this is a Pierce oscillator configuration. Well, Pierce is probably the most popular configuration. I'll even say it's not the best. The best would be something more symmetric in the end. But a Pierce is a single drive transistor here. With all the rest of this is just biasing here. There's a buffer that's going on to drive, see, measurement electronics of that sort. But this is your single drive transistor, and this is just a large bias resistor across this. It's an MOS resistor being used. And then you've got these capacitors around. So you need these shunt capacitors, C1 and C2. Okay. And the C3 generally comes from the transistor and from your tank device. So your tank device can be MEMS or it could be quartz. And so what I will do is I will compare MEMS with quartz to identify another huge advantage of MEMS over quartz just for designing oscillators. And so this thing is frozen again right now. And so now going back to this resonator that we looked at. So this is the wine glass disc resonator there. And now looking at some of the numbers here. So 13 megahertz quartz, Q maybe 10,000. Your CX over C naught KT squared for a lot of quartz is actually isn't that high. It's like 0.43% or something like that that we use a lot of these oscillators here. The shunt capacitance across the quartz, which is in this equivalent circuit here, maybe some tying these together there. It's on the order of 7 picofarads, so 7,000 femtofarads. Compare that to any of the MEMS. So here's the 10 megahertz clamp beam we looked at with 100 nanometer gap. That had a CX over C naught of 22%. Yes, it really was 22%. That's very difficult to beat again. But on top of that, its capacitance was 7 femtofarads. Okay, I'm going to keep harping on this capacitance, this wine glass disc, which we're actually going to design this oscillator. CX over C naught back down to 0.39% with gaps, I think, on the order of, this is either 40 or 80 meters. I think it's 40 there. The C naught, 34 femtofarads. You can see these C naughts being much smaller than the quartz C naught. And that's the big secret with MEMS. If you can maintain that small shunt capacitance, you can just kill the power of that oscillator and still retain similar performance as long as your Q is very high. And again, this Q here for the wine glass is 150,000. That's why we want to use it. So let's get to designing this oscillator. First, you need a model for your resonator. And I showed some equations for the model there. I guess I can expand this out to the actual resistance equation, which ends up being this. Everything's defined right here. I'm going to go a little quickly because we don't have much time left here. But say your frequency is on the order of 60 megahertz. The Q, 130,000. The RX, depending on your DC bias, anywhere between 5 and 15 kilohms for this. Now, I think it's an 80 nanometer gap because of those numbers there for the 80 nanometer gap here. And so that would be, say, your model for your device. And these are all designable here. And so here's what we're comparing. We're comparing a quartz design in the same Pierce-type circuit versus the MEMS design. And so when you design this Pierce circuit, this capacitor C3, which is 7 picofarads in quartz, it's very small in MEMS. I guess I showed 34 femtofarads in MEMS before. It really is going to be a little smaller because it's not just this overlap capacitance. It's from here to here. Okay, so that's probably going to be on the order of 15. I'm saying 5 right here for this example. But the larger this capacitance here, the larger your shunt capacitance has to be. And that shunt capacitance, C1 and C2, The size of that capacitance is what your transistor has to drive. And if that capacitance is larger, that transistor needs more current to drive those capacitors, which means that's more power consumption. So typically, for a quartz crystal oscillator trying to make a certain phase noise spec, the low capacitors in the picofarad range demand milliwatts of power. And if you can lower those low capacitors because you lower this shunt capacitor down to maybe 10 femtofarads, you're now looking at microwatts of power to get similar performance out of the two of them. Okay, so let's delve a little more deeply into that. So let's actually do some of the analysis to show why that's the case. So basically, that transistor circuit that I showed can be sort of boiled down to this. It's a transconductor, right? Your transistor with a GM times some voltage there. It's got this shunt capacitor, that shunt capacitor, sorry, and then this feed-through capacitor across it here, coming from the resonator and itself. Okay? And so the way an oscillator really works, again, it's a negative resistance type oscillator. This resonator here is going to have a finite resistance, real positive resistance. You need to hit that with a negative resistance of the same size to get the positive feedback oscillator to start going. Okay, so out of all of this, I want this C amp to be a negative resistance equal to the resistance of the resonator itself. Okay, so Cx plus C amp has to equal zero. If you go through and do the math, you will find that C amp, if this computer wants to cooperate, there it is. So C amp, at least the real part of Cm, which is what you're worried about, right? That's the resistance there. Takes on this form here, where it depends on this shunt capacitor C, so the feed through capacitor C3, and shunt capacitor C1 and C2. Now, if you look at this and you plot the real part of that Cm, so you're plotting this equation here, versus the GM of your transistor, which corresponds to the power consumed in that transistor, so the same scales right there, you'll see that it peaks out at a certain point here. But as long as this is larger than the motional resistance of your resonator, which is this black line here, we're saying it's 10 kilohms here, you will get a sustained oscillation, startup and sustenance of oscillation. This is the case where I have a very small feed through capacitor C3. It's a MEMS basically. If I double the size of that C3, this curve drops to here. It's no longer above that line, you will not get oscillation. But I can save myself just from this equation. It depends not just on C3, it's also C1 and C2. So if I raise C1 and C2, that peak, again, goes over that resistance line there. I will get oscillation, but look where I am on the curve here. Where before I was down at 200 microwatts of power, now I'm up in the milliwatt range. And just to get that GM. So this sort of, I hope, illustrates, and I know I'm doing it fairly quickly, the importance of that feed-through capacitor across the resonator, which is tiny in MEMS, it's huge in quartz. MEMS is a huge advantage in power consumption, just to get oscillation going. And yes, that loop power matters for phase noise, but if you have an enormous Q, like the 150,000 in the MEMS resonator, all that is a wash. You get still similar phase noise, maybe even better, but at much lower power consumption. Okay, so the demonstration of this, this is the resonator. I'm going to do this fairly quickly because we have these. This is the custom ASIC that is doing that here circuit. This is set up, this thing in a vacuum enclosure. You know, what we've been doing in university, we're not great packaging. We've been at least put this in a vacuum enclosure here. That's the at least obligatory oscilloscope waveform. And finally, this is the phase noise bullet. And so what you're looking at is GSM-like phase noise. So this is actually 60 megahertz, but divided down to 13 megahertz to normalize it so we can talk phase noise with GSM specs. The spec for GSM for the reference oscillator is better than 150 dBc, far from carrier, and you can see it's making that, and better than 1 kilohertz, or better than 130 dBc per hertz at 1 kilohertz offset. And you can see both of these curves make it. The difference between these curves is one of them is consuming 110 microwatts. That's using a smaller DC bias. But if you raise the DC bias to a little bit here, then you can do it at 78 microwatts. And I will say that, you know, if you don't need GSM performance, you can get oscillators down to 9 microwatts, actually, that are good enough for, say, that super regeneration-based receiver that I showed earlier in this talk. And so, proof of the pudding, the power control. gives them each plus, while the phase noise performance at least stays similar. Okay, huge advantage of MEMS comes from the capacitance there. Now, this is actually even done with bottom wire. So this actually is not as low a capacitance as you can get if you can integrate or have some much lower capacitance way to get the MEMS together with the circuits. You get even lower power consumption here. That is huge for IoT. It's huge for sensor networks, and it even can be big for things like wireless communications, even cell phones and that sort. All right, so you can do even more than this. I don't know how much longer you want to go. I mean, I'll go for the whole time before they kick us out. It's 3:30 right now. I'll just keep going here to see if I can finish. But, you know, you can use mechanical circuit approaches too. So all I've been talking about so far was single resonators with small gaps. You could actually take a number of these resonators and couple them together so you have an array of resonators. That actually gives you more power handling, more output current in this. And so the way this works, if I take a single one of these resonators that I have here, and I look at its output, maybe I'll just go for 10 minutes more because you probably want to take a break too before the next one. So I'll stop in 10 minutes more after this. But the single resonator, you know, it'll have a single response like this. If I hook all of these resonators up with coupling beams, okay, and I try to make them lambda over two coupling beams, what that does is give very strong coupling between them. Because they're all coupled together, they now will all vibrate in exactly the same mode. There's actually several different modes. So for example, there's one mode, and there's three of the modes that you would get out of this structure here. And I like this mode here, since everything is moving in unison. We can add all the currents on this, provided they all have the same frequency, and they do all have the same frequency, because they're linked together mechanically, which forces them into the same frequency mode. And it's a beautiful thing when you get all these resonators moving all at once in phase, which means that when you have three of these resonators together, you now get three times the output power. Okay? Now, there's a problem because you have three modes. If you're not careful with how you link these together, you'll get those three modes. If you do lambda over two coupling, ideally, that will push the other modes out to infinity. And you will never get ideal. So what it does is it just pushes the modes away. Right? You get this peak split there. And then you use clever electrode excitation to make sure you get the right mode. Right? If you excite these, you use phase the signals going to the electrodes and drive these things, you can knock out those modes there. And so in the end, you get the equivalent of a single resonator that has the power of multiple resonators. Motional resistance goes down. Power handling goes up, which means your phase noise can go down in an oscillator. And here's proof of the pudding. Okay, this is, say, one resonator. One of these wine glass discs, so that's a Q of 161,000. And here's now nine resonators coming together. You can see the RX is different by nine times in that case. And you can see a loss of a little bit of Q here, but the Q is still well over 100,000 for this 9 resonator array. Okay, and you can put this into an oscillator as well. This is a different oscillator design that won't perform as well as the Pierce that I just showed, but at least it's proof of the pudding that you can get these oscillators to work. And here's a single disk versus the 9 disk array. That's about 20 dB of difference in phase noise performance. That's at 60 MHz. This is divided down to 13 MHz. And you can see this also easily makes the GSM spec. If it were the Pierce, it would consume less power, but it would probably do even better than this one right here. Okay, so there's more tricks in the book here. Mechanical circuit design can allow you to get even better oscillators. And if I were to keep going on tricks, I would say design this to be very symmetric. This is still not a very symmetric design here. If you design it to be very symmetric, you'll kill off spurious modes that can absorb some of the energy. You get even higher Q. Keep more of that energy in the oscillator and get an even better oscillator out of this. Okay, so that's the oscillator design I was going to talk about. I can talk about acceleration sensitivity. Maybe I'll just breeze through this and not talk about it. You sort of read through this. I got some nice animations with this as well. But the bottom line is because these are tiny devices. Right, think about it. How do you make an accelerometer? You want a large proof mass. You want very compliant suspensions. How are we making these high-frequency resonators? We're making very stiff suspensions where we're getting as small a mass as possible so we can go up in frequency. This is an anti-accelerometer. And because of these, it's MEMS oscillators, and psi time has proven this. Different groups have proven this. analysis here. I guess in the end, the point is the gamma parameter that people usually measure for these things. And the gamma parameter for one of these oscillators measured on the order of 10 to the minus 10, which is not too shabby. Right? It could be better even beyond this. But when in this first demonstration here, 10 to the minus 10 is possible, you'll go more slowly through this. What's this now? So here's the FEI oscillator that's sort of designed for acceleration independence. Here's this oscillator. It's doing better. Here's what Dave Howard had done with an OCXO, which really pulled out on the stops to get very low acceleration sensitivity. And here's theoretically what we ought to be able to get, but we haven't gotten it because we think bond wires and that sort of thing are messing that up. Yes? Yes, yeah, you do actually. So if we go into the details, we'll just see two different mechanisms that probably dominate the acceleration sensitivity. One of them is that electrical stiffness that I talked about. Just the fact that these things move and then change the gap spacing, and that will then change the frequency. The other one is the actual stress that you get in the structure, the mechanical stress. And so in the Z direction, it's the electrical stiffness that dominates. In the X and Y direction, the electrical stiffness is canceled, and then it's the mechanical stresses that dominate. And so in the end, it's the Z direction, right? Well, yeah, you end up, right, this is the total vector here, and you can see the vector components here, the individual vectors. It's all there. I'm just sort of skipping through a little bit. I guess the last thing that I'll cover is drift on this. So how stable are these resonators? SciTime can give you much better data than I can give, right? I can only give an experiment that sort of was run on one of these wine glass discs. I'm even going through this experiment very quickly. I guess I'll just say a board was made. To do these aging tests, you have to really make sure that it's only aging that's happening. You've got to eliminate the change in temperature. And so you do that with multiple ovens. And so in this case, we had a double oven. This is one oven on a board where the actual resonator and circuit was sort of on a platform by itself and had these tethers holding it up. And then there were heating and temperature sensing resistors to keep that temperature stable. That then went into this environmental chamber right here. And then we tested this for a number of days. So what you see is a typical thing. It's an initial burn-in. And after that burn-in, it's very stable here. So you can see this is below about 50 ppb around here. And so this is just one of our lousy wine glass discs. Or I should say lousy, but it definitely is not as good of an experiment you can put together than maybe SciTime or that sort. But you're all already getting, you know, ppb, 50 ppb type stability over aging. And this was over, I guess you can see the elapsed hours of this. It's not over a year or something, right? You really need to do this over a longer period. But in a university, I guess, you know, we had to move labs at some point. So something happened that stopped this thing here. But you can actually see how good this is, even with just a rudimentary oscillator there. And this is polysilicon. And this is not single crystal silicon here. So it could be extremely good on that aging. This is the Allen deviation for this. You can see it coming down near 10 to the minus 8 or so. I know SciTime now has got 10 to the minus 9, and you could probably do even better than that eventually. So these things are for real, not only the single crystal stuff, but even the polycrystalline silicon stuff. And so finally, thermal drift. Maybe I should just let you go, right? It's already 10 minutes over. Yeah, so I'll let you go through thermal drift yourself. I'll just end it right here. But you can come up and talk to me about thermal drift if you want. I'll say one thing about thermal drift. Right? So the one thing I want to say is sort of what's happening now, and that is if you look into circuits, if you look at quartz on one hand versus MEMS on the other hand, then you wanted to find out how much power it took to keep this at a certain temperature. Because the best way to stop thermal drift is to just stop the temperature from changing. That means an oven. Okay, so in both of these situations, quartz and MEMS, you have the same thermal circuit, right, where you have a certain power coming in, you have a certain thermal resistance and a certain thermal capacitance. And so that thermal resistance is dependent on how long and thin the supports can be for that device. The thermal capacitance depends on the volume. So obviously you can see with MEMS, the volume's going to be much smaller, so you have a smaller thermal capacitance. At the same time, because it's a much smaller weight, you can hold it up with much longer tethers. So here's the long tethers in MEMS. And this quartz oscillator circuit basically probably
just sitting on top of something on feet or something, can't hold it up with toes. It'd be tough to do that. And so if you look at the thermal circuit, you derive the thermal resistance, for example, the thermal capacitance. For quartz, that's 160 Kelvin per watt. And thermal capacitance, 3.75 joule per Kelvin. For MEMS, that's 100,000 Kelvin per watt. Easily you can make thermal capacitance 10 to the minus 7 joule per Kelvin. There's orders of magnitude differences in that thermal circuit. And because you have those orders of magnitude differences, the power consumption needed to hold 50 degrees C in quartz would be 2 watts. And MEMS, 3 milliwatts. And that is a huge opportunity, I think, for quartz to go into the high-valued oscillator regime, or the high-performance oscillator, where you're looking to get these great Allen deviations with very low thermal drift. You can now do it with just orders of magnitude lower power than might have been possible with quartz. Okay, so with that, yes. That's actually true. So when Tom Kenny speaks, he's done this already. And you know, if you try to ask him, well, what about your fractional end synthesizer, his answer is going to be, we don't need one anymore. We're just adjusting our frequency with the oven. So it solves all sorts of problems. SciTech doesn't have this yet. No one has this yet. But this is research that's happened over many years. In fact, I did it as part of my PhD thesis when I was entering. Now it's been taken to a much bigger scale to the point where it really is making difference. The Tom's work at Stanford is just phenomenal. So with that, I think that's where I'm going to end it. Thanks very much. I'll stick